with you. If you are a guest here with us, would you go ahead and mind tearing this guest information card out and filling it out and putting it in the offering plate when it goes by? We would love to have that information from you. Please stand as we read God's word together this morning. Today's scripture reading today comes from the book of Luke, chapter 24, verses 28 through 35. They came near the village where they were going, and he gave the impression that he was going farther. But they urged him, "Stay with us, because it's almost evening, and now the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. It was as he reclined at the table with them that he took the bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, but he disappeared from their sight. They said to each other, "Weren't our hearts burning within us while he was talking with us on the road and explaining the scriptures to us?" That very hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem. They found the 11 and those with them gathered together, who said, "The Lord has truly been raised and has appeared to Simon." Then they began to describe what had happened on the road and how he had made known to them in the breaking of the bread. Let us pray. God, thank you for today where we get to come into your house and worship you freely. I thank you for what your son did for us on the cross, and I thank you for the gift of eternal life by believing in him. And I ask that we can remember that today as we take communion. In your name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. As you remain standing, let's sing together. He keeps me singing. Within my heart a melody, Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in our love lies ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, is my every longing. Singing as I go. All my life was wrecked by sin and strife. Discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus swept across the broken strings, stirred the slumbering chords again. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Feasting on the riches of his grace, resting neath the sheltering wing. Always looking on his smiling face, that is why I shout and sing. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Soon he's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown, I shall reign with him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I. As you're being seated, there's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. None else can heal all our souls' diseases. No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. There's not an hour that he is not near us. No, not one, no, not one. No night so dark but his love can cheer us. No, not one, no, not one. Jesus. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. Was there a gift like the Savior given? No, not one, no, not one. Will he refuse us a home in heaven? No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He all my grief has taken, and all my sorrows borne. In temptation he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken, and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the world forsake me, and Satan tempt me sore, through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he my hungry soul shall feed. Then sweeping up to glory, to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well.
It is well.
is well, it is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh, my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, is the day when the face shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul.
Let's all stand together.
It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul.
So have our ushers come forward now for our morning offering.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We pray that you would send us some rain, Lord. The earth is dry and we need the rain, Lord. Pray, Lord, that you would just bless this offering this morning. Let it be used for your honor and glory. Bless the gift and the giver. We thank you for your never-ending love. Let us be that Christian example that we need to be before each other and before the world. And may we reach out and touch those who need you as Lord and Savior. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Oh, how you worry, oh, how you weary from fear, and you've lost control. This was the one thing you didn't see coming, and no one would blame you, though. If you cried in private, if you tried to hide it away, so no one knows, no one will see. You stop believing. Oh, my soul, you are not alone. There's a place where fear has to face the God you know. One more day, he will make a way. Let
let him show you how you can lay this down. But you're not alone. Here and now, you could be honest. Won't try to promise that someday it all works out. This is the valley, and even now he is breathing on your dry bones. There will be dancing, there will be beauty where beauty was ash and stone. This much I know. Oh, my soul, you are not alone. There's a place where fear has to face the God you know. One more day, he will make a way. Let him show you how you can lay this down. I'm not strong enough, I can't take anymore. And my shipwreck may never get me to shore. You can find him here, you can keep me from going. Not alone. There's a place where fear has to face the God you know. One more day, he will make a way. Let him show you how you can lay this down. You're not alone. Oh, my soul, you're not alone.
Amen. Well, it's good to be home. If you have your Bible, we're not going to Romans this morning. We're going to Luke chapter 24. I encourage you to open your Bibles this morning to Luke, the Gospel of Luke chapter 24. As we prepare to worship together around the table this morning in the observance of the Lord's Supper, we want to take a moment to reflect on the importance of the Lord's Supper and this event leading up to or after the resurrection of Christ, leading up to his ascension, where there is a moment where Jesus breaks bread, and it's an impactful moment in the lives of these two men, one which is named Cleopas and the other is unnamed. Our text, we have these two men walking from Jerusalem to Emmaus, perhaps a journey of about 7 miles, take a couple of hours, and they're talking along the way. They're missing one key ingredient to the story, the truth. As they're sharing what of all the events that have happened in Jerusalem, we pick up in the story where these two guys are discouraged. They're disappointed, they're ignorant of the facts of what has happened in Jerusalem. They have some of the facts, but they don't have the whole story. And so they're certainly confused about what is going on. It's not that they didn't believe the Scripture. They just didn't have their full understanding of Scripture. Their understanding of Scripture is deficient. If you have a deficient understanding of Scripture, that's a dangerous place to be. You need a full understanding, the whole counsel of God from beginning to end. So it's important that you are always reading your Bible. You could read a book 20 times and find something new every time, something that you don't remember. Well,
These two fellows would be similar to the Aggie who went skydiving. He listened to the instructions. There were four commands he was told. First command, don't jump until you're told. Sounds simple enough. Second command, once you jump, count to 10. Then you pull the ripcord. Third command, if nothing happens the first time you pull the ripcord, pull the second ripcord. The fourth command, when you land, there will be a truck there to pick you up and take you back to the hangar. So they took off, and the Aggie was told to jump, and he jumped. He counted to 10. He pulled the first ripcord. Nothing happened. He pulled the second ripcord. Nothing happened. And disappointment overwhelmed him when he said, great, the truck probably isn't going to be there either to pick us up. Friends, don't let life, don't let culture, don't let changing times pull you away from the truth of God's word. It is the most important thing for our day and time as believers, as gospel-centered people. It is our most important foundation. And even in our story today, the slightest little flicker for Jesus of a flame will quickly be set to a burning heart when you open the Word of God and you break bread together with the church. Let's look at our text, verse 13. I'm going to read through verse 16. That very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. These two guys just have flickering hearts. There's a little flicker of a flame there. Not much, but there's just a small spark. And the first day of the week, still being Sunday, it's the day that Jesus has come back to life. And they've heard the stories as we get to the end and they tell Jesus what has happened. They've heard some of the stories, but there's still no sight of who Jesus is. So they've been with the band of disciples. Okay, these aren't any of the 12 or now 11. These are extras. But they've been in Jerusalem, they know what's been going on. And as they go through on their journey, talking with each other about all the things that had happened, here comes a divine interruption. A new traveler appears. Someone who's going to intervene in their life. Someone who's going to intervene and interrupt their story. And when we have these moments in our life when Jesus interrupts our story, we don't need to be aggravated. Because divine interruptions are for a purpose. You can see Moses, you can see David while he's out doing what he's supposed to do, tending the sheep. Divine interruptions happen, and we don't want to get upset with the Lord when he upsets your plans. When he upsets and intervenes in your life, because oftentimes in our plans, we get comfortable. And what I see in Scripture and what I know in life is that comfort begets complacency. Whereas discomfort caused by God's interruption in our life begets dependency upon God. And that's where the follower of Christ is. We are to be dependent on God 24/7. And so Jesus joins the pair on the road to Emmaus. Verse 16, their eyes are kept from recognizing him. They don't know. It's not because they're ignorant. They have seen Jesus. They're his disciples. Again, not the 12, but they're learners, they're students of Jesus. They know what he looks like. They know what he sounds like. But here's something that happens in Scripture. It happens twice in this text this morning. It's called a divine passive. It is God who is causing them not to see yet. It's not their own stupidity. It's not their own foolishness, although Jesus calls them that in just a few verses later. Slow of heart. But it is God who's causing them. And it's those moments where God is interrupting and he's doing this for a very specific reason. Because it's going to allow Jesus to teach from the Scriptures everything about him. All of the prophecies, all the way going back to Moses. To show that what Jesus has done fulfills Scripture. And we come to the table this morning, and if we come to the table without the belief that Jesus completely fulfilled all of Scripture, this is empty and meaningless. Everything we just sang, if we believe that Jesus didn't completely fulfill all the scriptures about him, that he was not completely who he said he was or who he claimed to be, all of this morning is meaningless. And your relationship with him is meaningless. It is important for these two men who are walking and talking about what has happened in Jerusalem to get the full picture of who Jesus is. Scripture fulfilled is scripture that is true. Scripture fulfilled is scripture that is reliable. Scripture that is fulfilled is scripture that is trustworthy. And it's very important that we have this book, this word, his word, as our foundation in knowing that it is reliable and it is trustworthy. Look at verse 17. Good old Jesus. He always knows how to start a new conversation. See the woman at the well, John 4. He says to them, "What is this conversation that you're holding with each other as you walk?" What are you talking about? What's going on, fellas? As if he didn't know. Well, their disillusionment, their disappointment, their doubt, all of those things come out, and it's very evident because, as Luke says, they stood still looking sad. They froze, amazed at what this visitor, this man, just asked. "Where have you been, dude? It's like you've been out of the country or something." It's not captured by words. Notice it's captured by body language. Communication is about 90% nonverbal. They're looking sad. Jesus, by asking this question, begins to add a little fuel to the fire, the small flicker that's in their heart. Look at verse 17 and 18. Then one of them, named Cleopas, verse 18, answered, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, the man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some of the women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see." Well, Jesus has opened up the cap to the fuel tank now, and he's going to begin pouring some fire on this. They're stunned by this question. "Where have you been? What have you been doing? What, you must be new to this area. You must have just come into town to not know all the things that have happened." Friend, the death of Christ on the cross, it is a historical fact. It is there in the history pages. It's not a fairy tale. Okay? It's not made up by some man by the name of Walt Disney. Okay? It is a real life event. There are records outside of Scripture of this man named Jesus who was crucified. And it's not a secret right now as to what had happened in the last days in Jerusalem. Anybody in Jerusalem would have known what had happened to Jesus. And these guys are just stunned that he doesn't know. And naturally, Jesus is going to continue adding a little fuel by saying, "Well, what are you talking about? What things happened?" And so Cleopas begins to talk about it, and he correctly identifies the main character of the story, Jesus. Again, he doesn't know he's talking to him, but he correctly identifies him. He's Jesus of Nazareth, and he gives us a brief description. "He's a prophet," Cleopas says. Well, that's accurate. Check in the scriptures again, and you will see that Jesus often referred to himself as a prophet in the Gospels, and others did as well. In fact, in this very Gospel, Luke chapter 7, verse 16, here's a story captured by Luke at the end, a summation, where he says, "Fear seized them all," talking about the crowds. "They glorified God by saying," in reference to Jesus, "a great prophet has arisen among us. God has visited his people." Now that's being said about Jesus. So Cleopas isn't wrong by saying that he was a great prophet. Notice next, Cleopas says that he was powerful in deed and word. Well, of course we know that. We know some of the stories in the Gospels, the feeding of the 5,000 plus, feeding of the 4,000 plus, walking on water, raising Lazarus back from the dead, healing the sick. We know that he was powerful in deed and word. In fact, Luke, when he writes the book of Acts, he opens writing to Theophilus. He says, "Oh, Theophilus, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach," referencing Luke's work of the gospel. Peter references in Acts chapter 2, verse 22, "Men of Israel, hear the words, Jesus of Nazareth, the man attested to you by God, and mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know." So Cleopas is right by saying that this man, Jesus of Nazareth, was powerful in word and indeed and in word. Notice he was also before God. If you go back to Jesus' baptism, you'll remember he comes up out of the water, the Holy Spirit descends in the form of the dove, and then we hear this voice, "This is my Son with whom I am well pleased," right? This is before God. Everything Jesus does, everything he says, he first hears the Father say. Everything he does, he first sees the Father doing. Everything according to the will of God. And he does it before all the people. So everyone would have seen. Look at verse 20. It's interesting here. These two lay the blame for the crucifixion at the feet of the Jewish authorities. Now, that's a pretty accurate description because they are the ones who seized him and arrested him and brought him before the Roman government. And, of course, the Romans are the ones who passed the sentence down. But it is the Jews who cried, "Crucify him, crucify him, give us Barabbas." In reality, it was all of our sin that put him at the cross. Verse 21, I think verse 21 is profound because he says, "We had hoped that he was the one." This shows right here that these two men don't believe Jesus is alive. It shows, secondly, that these two men had misplaced hope. They had a misunderstanding of who the Messiah would be. It's not abnormal. Judas had the same thing, and many of the disciples did as well. In fact, if you read Acts chapter 1, they're ready for Jesus to start the kingdom now. They had a misplaced hope. Their understanding was political rather than spiritual or biblical of how the Christ would redeem Israel and ultimately all of creation. Friends, misplaced hope is empty. Misplaced hope is no hope at all. And that's why these men, if you go back to verse 17, they stood still looking sad. Why? Because they lost their hope. Their hope was misplaced. Their hope was not in Jesus Christ. When you look outside our doors this morning, and we've got a city full of people without hope. We've got a nation full of people without hope because they have misplaced hope. The only place we can put our hope is in the Scriptures fulfilled, which teach us about the one who fulfills our hope, Jesus Christ. For these men, redemption meant Israel's freedom from Rome. That's why they lost their hope. They tied what happened back in Israel in the Old Testament when God freed his people from Egypt through Moses. They tied it all the way back then to what the Messiah was supposed to be in their day and time. In fact, it's the very same word when we see, "But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel." It's the same word. Here it's in Greek, there in Hebrew, but it's the same word. It means the same thing. And it's a reference back to that Old Testament freeing of God's people. But for Luke, when you read his gospel, Luke doesn't present that picture for us. Jesus, in fact, did redeem Israel for Luke in his gospel. And he redeemed Israel and brought in the kingdom of God. He ushered it in. And it is still real and alive today. It is Christ who sets us free. Paul says in Galatians 5:1, "For freedom, Christ has set us free." But these two yahoos missed it because they had misplaced hope. Maybe that's where you are this morning. You've got hope that's been disappointed because it was in the wrong place. It's in the wrong person. It's in the wrong God. Notice one more time. "What is more," they say, "it's the third day." It's the third day. Verse 22 and 23, some of the women's stories, well, they amazed us at what they were saying. It was astounding. They went to the tomb. It was empty, but they didn't see his body. And they're claiming to have visions of angels and all of these things happening. And yet, there's still no resurrection sighting. Still, with these two, the truth had not clicked. There's a fire, but it's just flickering. It's just flickering. Verse 24, others went to the tomb. And they found it empty, but they did not see him. Where is his body? Where is he? They've got stories of the resurrection. They've got claims of visions of angels and messages from God through his messengers at the tomb. But there is no Jesus. Where is he? No resurrection sightings. What are they to do? Their hope is gone. What can we think? What can we believe? And then Jesus has had enough. Verse 25. And he sets their hearts on fire. Here we see hearts set ablaze. And he said to them, O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them and all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if he was going further, but they urged him strongly, saying, Stay with us, for it's toward evening, and the day is far spent. So he went in to stay with them, and when he was at the table with them, he took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And he vanished from their sight, and they said to each other, Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures? Jesus begins to work on their heart, the great cardiologist of spiritual matters. They're foolish because the evidence is before them, and yet they will not believe. That sounds like a lot of people today. The evidence is before us when it comes to believing God, and yet we refuse to believe. Have you ever been involved in a conversation where you thought you knew what you were talking about, and you were telling everyone everything you know about whatever you're talking about? You're certain you know what you're talking about. You're absolutely, without a doubt, completely knowledgeable about the subject, only to find out later that what you should have done was opened your mouth and inserted your foot because you really didn't know what you were talking about. That's kind of like Cleopas and his traveling partner here. Well, it could be like the three elderly men who decided to go to a health screening. They didn't want to go by themselves, you know, macho man, but if they figured the other two went with them, then they could blame it on the other two and not themselves. So they get before the doctor, and it's a memory test. And the doctor says to the first kind gentleman, Sir, what is 1 + 1? He thinks for a second, and he says, 274. The doctor's puzzled at that. So he turns to the second man. Okay, your turn. What's 1 + 1? And the second man says, Tuesday. Now the doctor's really confused. Surely the third time's the charm. So he turns to the third man. He's like, all right, what's 1 + 1? The gentleman thinks about it for a minute. 2. And the doctor lights up with joy. Great, how did you get that? And this guy said, well, that was very simple. I just subtracted 274 from Tuesday. Confusion about who Jesus is can cause complacency and a heart that doesn't burn. But when the truth of who Jesus is encounters your heart ought to be set ablaze. You ought to say, like Cleopas and his traveling partner, were not our hearts burning while we read the scriptures and the Spirit spoke to our heart through God's word? These two had not placed all the evidence they had against the greatest source of knowledge they had, which was the scriptures, which is why Jesus goes all the way back to Moses. They had time. Oh, to be a part of that sermon and to hear the words from Jesus explaining the Old Testament. explaining the prophets, explaining Ezekiel's vision of dry bones. What if Jesus had used that vision of Ezekiel saying, guys, this is what's happened right here. The dry bones, they're coming to life. Verse 25 and 27, Jesus is teaching from the Scriptures. It reminds me of 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. For all Scripture is inspired by God. That Scripture is trustworthy. That Scripture is useful for teaching, for rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. These guys had it all backwards. Their understanding of who Jesus is. First, the Messiah would set up the earthly kingdom before he died. But Jesus was well aware. He knew things were different. He knew Isaiah 53, the prophecy of the suffering servant. Jesus knew Psalm 22, verse 1, my God, why have you forsaken me? In fact, he quoted it on the cross. He knew. But the problem was these two guys, it's not because they were slow thinkers. Their real problem is the heart. It's always the heart. Until we understand that it's the heart that now in Christ, God comes through His Son to take the heart of stone and put a living heart there, to take up residence. But these two guys are still cold to the truth of God. Verse 28 to 32, it's this one life-changing moment. It's this one life-changing moment, and the key moment happens in verses 30 and 31. Most likely not the Lord's Supper here as he did the night before he was crucified, but it's very similar. Would have been very customary to break bread. In fact, we see the church doing that in Acts chapter 2, 42 through 47. It's one of the things that the church is said to be practicing with Luke, that they're breaking the bread together. The similarities to the Lord's Supper are striking. He takes the bread. He blessed, broke it, and gave it. It is that exact moment when God lifts the veil from their eyes. When God wanted Jesus, His Son, to be recognized by these two men. Through the teaching of the Scriptures and the fellowship and the breaking of bread, these two disciples come to an understanding. This is Jesus. This is Jesus in the flesh. They have certainty of His resurrection. He is alive. And yet, just as they recognize Him, He's gone. Back to Jerusalem He goes. Verse 32. Now these two men have another conversation without Jesus. Were not our hearts burning within us as He talked to us on the road while He opened to us the Scriptures? Does God's Word do that for you? Do you just read it? Maybe you have it on your phone as an app to read a devotional. Maybe you sit down in your chair in the morning with your coffee. When you read the Word of God, does it burn inside of you? Does it burn in your heart? I'm not talking heartburn from the meal you had tonight when you overate. I'm talking about a spiritual burning in your heart, on the inside of your guts. Does it light a fire in you when you open the Word of God? It should. Does it bother you? Does it disturb you in a good way? It should. It did for Cleopas and his friend. Their grief, their disappointment, the poor perspective of truth, their doubt blinded them from the truth. Ultimately, it's God, but here in their realm, in their life, it's all of these things that are blinding them to the truth. It blinded them from what God was doing through His Son. But listen, resurrection faith was more than just physical sight. It's more than just physical presence. Resurrection faith, as Jesus tells Timothy, is blessed, Thomas, blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed. That's resurrection faith. And that's what we need. Our burning heart causes that resurrection faith, spiritual presence, spiritual sight. They knew something was happening on the road. They can look back and say, wait a minute, I remember my heart started burning when He started teaching us. And then it's not until that bread is broken when God is revealed. Here is what the Son of God has done for you. His body was broken on the cross. paid for you. The story doesn't stop there. Look at 33 through 35. They rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. Now, wait a minute. I thought the day was over and they needed to stay inside. It wasn't safe to go outside at night. Travel 7 miles all the way back to Jerusalem, that'd take another 2 or 3 hours. They found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, "The Lord has indeed risen indeed and has appeared to Simon." And then they told what had happened on the road. And he was known to them in the breaking of bread. They get back to that special room. And they find out that their story was not unique. They find out that their story is added to the rest of the stories of his disciples and his followers who have seen him alive. But notice that these two say something different. They emphasize that their recognition only came through the breaking of bread. This morning, we're going to break bread together. We are going to drink from the cup of the new covenant. And I pray it will stoke the glowing embers of your heart to a glorious blaze, because ultimately we are called to let that light shine. These two men left immediately, that very hour, 7 miles back to Jerusalem to go tell people that they had seen the risen Jesus. They are letting that burning heart shine. That's what we're called to do. As we come to the table, we need to be people with burning hearts. Every time we open the Word of God, our hearts need to burn a little bit brighter. They went to tell the others, "Let your burning light shine before men." That's what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 5 in the Sermon on the Mount. "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Let your light shine before others, that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." When we let our light shine, we're working for the Lord. Let your burning heart shine for all to see. Let your burning heart overflow so that the words that come out of your mouth are the gospel. It's good news, the gospel truth that Jesus is alive and that Jesus is our only hope. He is our real hope in this world that's quickly going to hell. Let's pray together. Father, as we come to your table this morning, I pray as we gather and have gathered our hearts in worship, that this story of what has happened to Cleopas and the unnamed man will cause a stirring in our hearts, a stirring that our hearts would burn bright for you. A stirring in which we remember Jesus is alive. As we come to the table, a fellowship table, Lord, I thank you for the body of our Savior hung upon a cross. No bones broken, as Scripture promised and prophesied, and yet his body completely bruised and beaten. And as he hung there in the spilling of his blood, we are grateful for the sacrifice. We are grateful for the substitute who took our place. Lord, help us in this hour. Stoke the embers of our heart to burn bright and to burn for you. I'm going to ask that you take just a moment as Amber begins to play. The invitation this morning is this: that you would just settle yourself before the Lord. If there is anything unclean in you this morning, a sin you're holding on to, It's not to be harbored in your life. It's to be given over to the Lord. I invite you to confess that this morning before you come to the table. If you're facing a temptation that's not sin yet, but it's glaring in front of you, offer that to the Lord. If you've neglected His word, offer that to the Lord. Set it right this morning. If you have failed to honor Him as Lord of your life, asking Him to bless your plans rather than receiving the blessed plans of God, fix that this morning. I'm going to ask our deacons who are helping to serve this morning if you would come forward. Every head bowed, every eye still closed, as we continue to prepare to receive the supper. Father, as we come to the table, pray that you would bless this meal, Father, and we thank you in the name of Jesus. And we do this morning in remembrance of Him. Deacons, you are dismissed to serve the body. Once again, for your body, offered up upon the cross to pay for our sin. After He had given thanks, Jesus took the bread, He broke it. He said, "This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." the same way, Jesus took the cup. He said, this cup is symbolic of the new covenant sealed in my blood. As often as you drink from this cup, do so in remembrance of me. As often as we do this, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And we all say, come, Lord Jesus, come. Amen? Amen? Amen. Thank you, guys. A couple of announcements for you this morning before we go to Bible study. This afternoon at 5, we'll have our regular monthly business meeting. This is an important meeting. We will have a recommendation from our...
I want to thank you for tuning in today, First Baptist Gonzales, and worshiping with us this morning. I want you to remember that you are loved, first and foremost, by Jesus Christ. He gave his life for you on the cross, and it is a life-changing choice to believe in him, to call on his name. The Bible says that whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, in Romans 10:13. I want to urge you to call on him today. If you have already made Jesus your Savior and Lord, maybe this morning as a result of the service, would you do us a favor and call here at the church, 672-9595. Let us know of your choice, and we want to celebrate with you. We'd also like to pray for you. You could call the church office again or send us an email or write us a letter and let us know how our prayer ministry could lift you and your family up to our Heavenly Father who cares about you and your family. Thanks again for watching. Pray that you enjoy our service, that you're able to worship along with us, and we'll see you here next time on TV 17. God bless.